Lord, you reminded Jerusalem how often you wanted to gather them together. As a hen protects her young beneath her wings. But Jerusalem wouldn't let you. Am I any different? Your own children killed your prophets. They stoned your messengers. Can I claim any innocence? Your word is my light. But how often do I choose the darkness instead? You are my salvation. But how often do I choose rebellion? Forgive me, Lord. You are my fortress. I seek to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Delighting in you, Lord. Meditating on your word, Lord. Be merciful and answer me, Lord. Do not turn your back. Do not reject me in anger. You are my helper. Don't leave me now. Don't abandon me, Lord. Hold me close. Teach me how to live. Amen.
Good morning. How are we all doing today? Good. Let's stand up. We're going to worship.
Conquered the grave.
me. All that you've done for me.
Coming in. Good morning. Oh, we got a little energy here this morning, scattered around. So we do have quite a few things going on right now. So Alabaster, this is the last Sunday for it. Although probably if you give next week, we'd take it. But Alabaster, remember to give for that. All of that goes towards building churches, hospitals, schools, parsonages on the missions field. So we want to definitely support that. Today we do have teen quiz practice at 4:30, kids quiz practice at 5 o'clock, youth group at 6. I did not look to see if we have a meal tonight or not. We do? Okay.
Maria's bringing it.
Okay. We do have a meal covered tonight. Thank you. Tuesday night, we have Bible study at 7 o'clock, barring weather or mass illness, but we're aiming for Tuesday night at 7 for that. Wednesday night is our last Wednesday of the month. So that is ladies' night out, 6 o'clock at Monocles this time. So 6 o'clock at Monocles. I will not be there, but y'all get together and have a good time. Eat a piece of pizza for me, or two, or three. Coming up, we've got several different things. March 9th, we've got District Celebrate Life for the teens. We need to get registered for that this week. And our NYI convention is also March 9th. March 15th and 16th, we've got Superstart for our 4th through 6th graders. March 16th, there is a quiz here. We are going to provide the lunch for that. So I will have a sign-up sheet in the back if people would like to help with some of that. We're just going to do what we've done before, some barbecues, chips, cookies, veggies, water. That's gone over really well. But anybody who is interested in helping with that, that sign-up sheet will be in the back at the end of the service. March 16th is also our district reporting day at Grace Community down in Tilton. So that's from 9 to 12. So you've got two activities to choose from that you can come and support our church. March 17th, we're going to have an all-church potluck after the service. And then March 24th is our kids' party. That is also Palm Sunday, which means March 31st is Easter. It's only like a month away, which is a little crazy. It seems like 2024 is just flying past us. We do have dates for teen camp and kids' camp. Teen camp was just, I think, like 2 or 3 days ago. We figured out what that was. So teen camp is going to be at Indian Lake Campgrounds in Vicksburg, Michigan, and that is June 10th through the 14th. And kids camp is going to be on the campus of Olivet, and that is July 11th through the 14th. So we'll have registration information as we get it for those, but those are both coming up, and that should be some exciting times. And back to you, Layton.
Thank you, Carrie. All right, who couldn't stand to be a little more like Jesus? See what I did there?
Talk the talk that I don't walk, and miss the moments right before my eyes. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped, somebody with a hand that I could have held, when I just can't see past myself. Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Yeah, there's no denying I have changed. I've been saved from who I used to be. Even at my best, I must confess, I still need help to see the way you see. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped. Somebody with a hand that I could have held. When I just can't see past myself, Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Oh, to feed the beggar on the street, love to be your hands and feet, freely give what I receive, Lord, help me be. I want to put you first above all else, love my neighbor as myself, to the moments no one sees, Lord, help me be. A little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me, a little more like living, everything I breathe, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me.
Right, you guys can have a seat. Kind of caught Violet off guard. She mentioned that she liked that song on the way to Danville. So I was like, I guess what? We're doing it. I'd like to invite the kids now to come on up and hang out with Maria.
So good morning. I'm sure you guys know what these are. Yeah. Yep, you can play with one. Oh no, let's share. Hey, do you want? Would you like this one instead? Yeah, there you go. Okay. Anyone else want to come up? Now, just keep it in your hands. Keep it in your hands or keep it in the cup, okay? Let's not touch the ground with it, okay? Now, you can busy your hands, but make sure your ears are also listening. Yes, you can, just in your hands, not on the floor or anything. So, how is Play-Doh different from other toys? How is Play-Doh different from other toys? Yeah, even though it's safe, it's non-toxic. Don't eat it. Yeah, yeah. Ryan makes sure that he enhances his palate. How is it different from like other action figures or dolls or video games? You can squish it, yeah. You can change its shape. You can throw it at a wall. Please don't throw it at a wall.
Yeah.
No, we're not gonna do
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
You can
break
it. You can change its shape.
Can I make a heart Play-Doh?
You can make a heart Play-Doh.
Audrey, what does this taste
like? Don't let her try it. Okay, so we are going to talk about what we have in common with Play-Doh.
I have one.
What?
I have something that isn't, like, salt tastes like this.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, I have a salt tastes like, a puppy.
Oh, okay. So I'm going to read two verses. One, and they're coming from Romans chapter 12. So verse 1 says, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." So this verse was written at a time when people brought many kinds of offerings or sacrifices to God. Some brought grain or animals to God to say that they were sorry for something they had done or to say thank you for a blessing. This verse was becoming a living offering themselves might have come as a surprise to people who were used to bringing something else to God. This verse says offering ourselves to God is true and proper worship. So what do you usually think of when you hear the word worship? What do you think of when you hear the word worship? What's worship? Do you think of church? Mm-hmm. Worship and church. What else do we do to worship? Okay, a church monster, a church enthusiast. You're so silly. All right, you are a church monster. So what does it mean to offer our... Sure, you want to come sit next to me? What does it mean to offer our lives to God? What does it mean to offer our lives to God? Or what do you think living sacrifice means? You think sacrifice is when you save someone?
Like when you play 10 at school, the first one to get the 10, like you only go three numbers, and somebody sacrificed herself to save me.
So you give yourself up.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, that's a good one. How can we offer ourselves to God? Can pray. How else? We can look for believing friends to encourage us. We can look for ways to serve others. Let me read Romans 12:2. It says, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." Do you know that verse? Oh, so what does the rest of it go? "Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." So this verse hints that we are kind of like Plato. We can be changed by what is around us. By what mold we squeeze into. That's where it says conform. God wants us to offer our lives to him. If we do, he will mold us like a ball, change us to be more and more like him, full of goodness and love and grace. But some things in the world tempt us not to give ourselves to God. I know it's funny, but it doesn't taste good. It's not for eating.
It tastes like pink.
It doesn't have a taste.
And I have another thing that's in common. You can make a person.
Mm-hmm. Yep, you can conform yourself.
I make you
Go ahead and make a heart.
I make mommy.
You can. Go ahead. So some things tempt us not to give ourselves to God. When we focus on those things, we'll soon be molded into a life that ignores God. We can become so worried about pleasing others that we'll do what they say, even when we know it is wrong. We can end up filled with fear, hatred, and worry. God doesn't want that for us because he loves us. That's right. What are some things in the world that try to press you into their mold? So what are some things that press ourselves into a mold for things that God wouldn't want us to do? Okay. Like, maybe if someone says, Ryan, you should go and push that weird kid in recess. Is that something that God would want us to do? No, you don't want to push them. You don't want to push. If someone said, hey, go push Gabe over there. No, that's not nice. That's not a good thing to do. Yeah, like that's kind of being a bully, if you ask me. Okay, go ahead. Just don't do it on the carpet, please. Do it with your hand. So how can you be transformed in the renewing of your mind? In other words, how can you tell God to change you instead of the world changing you? How can you ask God for that? How can we ask God to change us so that we don't conform to that bad idea? We could pray. We could pray God ask us to lead us. We could read the Bible. Very nice. Why is it important to know God's will, to know what God wants for us? Why is it important for us to follow God? Why is it important that we go to church? So we can learn about him. So that we know. So that we know what's best, what God wants, what's best for us. So Lent is a special time when we ask God to make us more like him. So, just like him, exactly. I love how that is still going on. So, what we're going to do now is we are going to not take it home. It's going to stay at the church. We'll do something else in the back there. Now, what I want everyone to do, we're going to say a little prayer. So close your hands together. Close your eyes and bow your head. We're going to pray. God, you made us. You know what is best for us. Help us to give others to you as a living sacrifice. Transform us to be more and more like you. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead and head on to the back. We have a game and snacks.
A game?
Good morning. Whoa. Stand by. Testing 1, 2, testing 1, 2, 3, 4. Test 1, 2, 1, 2. Hey. Okay. There we go. How is everybody? Good. I wanted to do that after, like, the whole time she said. All Who all's been reading their devotionals every day?
Oh, you guys. You guys, I tell you.
Oh, you said every day.
Every day, yeah. Should be reading it every day. Takes like 5 minutes, tops. You'll be done. So, three more things I wanted to mention as far as announcements go. Next week, we do have an Olivet student coming to preach. You're welcome. Yeah. His name is Aiden Christensen. Not to be confused with Hayden Christensen, which played Anakin Skywalker on Star Wars. His name is Aiden Christensen. I have to stop myself and say it right because it's crazy close. But he is going to come and he's going to preach for us next week. We have Man Camp coming up in April, gentlemen. I do not know the numbers of anything yet. April 5, 6, and 7th. Don't know costs or anything yet. Don't know details about who's going to be there or what's happening exactly. But if you've been to Man Camp, you know what it's like. If you've not been to Man Camp, you need to go because it's awesome. I know, I would love to. But that is coming up, April 5, 6, 7. FCA camp is July 22 through 25. So if we have our kids, it is a middle school camp. So if we would like to go to that, you can sign up for that soon. Link to sign up is not active yet, but just giving you a heads up that that's coming July 22 through 25. Since all of you aren't reading your devotionals every day, I'm going to read today's. This is written by N.T. Wright, which is a pretty popular Nazarene writer, author. Says, worship will never end. Whether there be buildings, they will crumble. Whether there be committees, they will fall asleep. Don't fall asleep. Whether there be budgets, they will add up to nothing. For we build for the present age. We discuss for the present age. And we pray for the present age. But when the age to come is here, the present age will be done away. For now we see the beauty of God through a glass, darkly, but then face to face. Now we appreciate only part, but then we shall affirm and appreciate God, even as the living God has affirmed and appreciated us. So now our tasks are worship, mission, and management, these three, but the greatest of these is worship. Worship is nothing more or less than love on its knees before the beloved, just as mission is love on its feet to serve the beloved. I am going to start out with scripture again this morning. We're going to be in Romans chapter 12. And we're doing verses 1 through 21. These are relatively short verses comparatively. It won't take us too long to get through this, but we're going to do Romans 1 through 21. Romans 12, 1 through 21. There we go. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought,
but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If your gift is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Love in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay," says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Sacrifice is a fairly common part of our vocabulary, and it's often used in conjunction with family life, right? We hear that a lot. Parents are told that they have to sacrifice things in order to raise good children. Good children. That might be sacrificing quiet and relaxing vacations, using the bathroom alone, maybe sleeping through the night. Parents definitely do make sacrifices. Sacrifice is also required in order to have a good relationship with a spouse, right? We sacrifice a lot for the other person that we love. Sometimes you sacrifice the time you would like to spend on yourself because your spouse needs you. Or you sacrifice a job you like in order to give your spouse an opportunity to pursue a career that they might find fulfilling. But you also sacrifice to give to go back to school, to move somewhere new, or even to take that dream vacation. Usually, choosing one thing means sacrificing something else. Life is filled with sacrifices. We make a lot of them all the time. Sacrifice isn't meant to be easy. It's supposed to cost us something. The imagery of sacrifice in the Old Testament involves blood and death and fire, all the good stuff, right? It's definitely not ease and comfort. In one story, King David wants to dedicate a field to the Lord, and the owner of the field offers to give it to David for free. But David's response is that he won't offer the Lord something that costs him nothing. Sacrifice costs us something, which makes it hard, which means our text from Romans 12 is kind of difficult. We're told to offer up our bodies as a living sacrifice. It's true and proper worship. That means that our physical bodies matter.
Sometimes we are tempted to elevate the spirit over the body and say the body doesn't matter, only the spirit. But that impulse isn't in line with Christian tradition. The Apostles' Creed affirms that the resurrection of the body. The incarnation of Jesus shows us how much bodies matter to God because God chose to become human with a body. Jesus actually died in the body, and he actually rose again with a body. So during his ministry, Jesus demonstrated that he cared about bodies by feeding them and healing them and existing in one. Bodies matter to God, which means they should matter to us too. It might be easier to imagine a living sacrifice as a spiritual command rather than a physical one, but it is not. What we do with our bodies, how we exist in our bodies, and how we treat our bodies, as well as how we treat the bodies of others, all these things matter. What we do with our bodies is connected to worship, because there is no such thing as worship that is not embodied. When we worship, we sing, we move, we pray, we stand, we sit, we stand, we sit, we stand again, we listen, we read, we taste, we touch, communion. Worship involves our bodies. Worship and our bodies are also connected in the ways that we care for others. We clothe the naked. We visit the sick and the imprisoned. We offer food and water to those that don't have food and water. These are all ways that we use our bodies to worship God by caring for the bodies of others. Being a living sacrifice means we don't conform to the patterns of this world. The patterns of this world include desiring power, wanting wealth, fame, beauty. If we don't conform to those patterns, then we don't hate, we don't mistreat, or we don't abuse our bodies if they don't look the right way. Don't use our bodies to get ahead. Don't treat others' bodies as a means to an end for ourselves. Verse 3 in Romans 12 also comes into play. Do not think more highly of yourself than you ought. Don't create a hierarchy where you're better than others. The early church focused a lot on pushing against the hierarchy-based system of that day, which meant that the early Christian congregations were made up of people from all over the social spectrum, when normally they would be expected to be separated out by status. And don't be arrogant about who you are. Titles and social class are irrelevant to God. We each have different gifts, and we're expected to use those gifts to build up the body of Christ. Whether that's serving or preaching or encouraging or any of the many things and the gifts that God has given God's people, being a living sacrifice means offering our gifts in unselfish ways to the community or the people around us. We use our gifts and our talents for the betterment of others instead of as a way to get ahead, which is what the world does. We also recognize when we're not gifted. We have to recognize when we don't have a gift to do something and allow others who are gifted in ways that we aren't to flourish and thrive. Sometimes that's hard to give up stuff that we like even though we're not gifted in it. We need each other. Humanity creates space for us to work together as the body of Christ. Being a living sacrifice is ultimately centered in love. Love in this text is described in embodied ways. Being joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer, sharing with those in need, practicing hospitality, blessing those who persecute us, rejoicing with those who rejoice, mourning with those who mourn, living in harmony with one another, and not being conceited, not repaying evil for evil, but doing what is right, living at peace with everyone, not taking revenge on our enemies. During Lent, we take intentional time to put into practice embodied spiritual disciplines like fasting. The way we use our bodies can draw us closer to God and to each other, or further away. When we engage in spiritual disciplines, we're reminded that we're dependent on God and on community of faith. We aren't meant to do it alone. Taking time to intentionally set our bodies aside as living sacrifices through spiritual disciplines is also a great time to ask questions of ourselves. What gifts do I have that can contribute to the body of Christ? What gifts do I not have that I need to step back from? Where do I need to live more humbly with others? Am I living at peace with others? Am I being overcome by evil? Or am I overcoming evil with good? Am I rejoicing with those who rejoice? And am I mourning with those who mourn? All very, very important questions that we should regularly ask ourselves. And in Romans 12, verse 2, it tells us that if we're living sacrifices who aren't conformed to the patterns of the world, we will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. So in this season of Lent, we should long for God to reveal his will to us. But we find God's will when we live in intentional ways that set us apart, when we live in holiness. We discover the gifts that we have that should be used for the sake of others. When we live lives of embodied love to the world around us, we're in the center of God's will. How's God calling you to be a living sacrifice? Sacrifice might look different to you than it does for somebody else. It might be deciding to put yourself and your gifts out there for the first time, and that can be hard and scary to do. I just finished writing 2 books, which is something I never thought I would do in my entire life because I could barely read books. But sometimes we just have to step out there and give our gifts to the world because we're called to do something. It could be taking time out of your day or your week to do something for someone else. It could just be taking time to discover what you're gifted at in the first place so that you can better serve in that capacity. But this living out of faith, this caring for one another, this humbling of ourselves, this is all worship to God. We're living worship. We don't just worship while we're here. Our lives should be worship. It costs us something, but it's also true and proper worship. As we pray this morning, we got a few people that we need to remember. We need to remember Julie's mom, Carrie, who's going through some medical concerns right now, and she needs our prayers. We need to still remember Susan Looning. We need to remember Rita. Rita is home. Rita is still trying to get over pneumonia. She needs to heal from the pneumonia. And then she has to go back and talk about having back surgery because she has popped out some vertebrae. And Olivia is on her way to Guatemala for her missions trip that we helped her get to. So your dollars at work helping Olivia get to where she needs to go to do the work of God. So let's keep her in prayer as she travels, as she does the work, and as she travels back home. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for bringing us here again today. I am so grateful for the opportunity to be near these people and to live life with these people and to love these people and to be loved by these people. Lord, even when things are hard, you have still given us so many good things. And you promised us that you would always be with us no matter how hard life gets, and that we can lean on you to help us get through these moments. And I pray that over these families who are struggling right now. You never promised us it would be easy. You never promised us bad things wouldn't happen. In fact, you said they would. We would go through hard times. But Lord, please just help us to know that you're here every single step of the way. We can have the knowledge of that, but help us to feel that in our heart. Help us to be aware of the Holy Spirit's presence in this room today and wherever we go. Lord, I pray for Carrie Tavener. You know the concerns with the cancer and whatever else is going on, Lord, we give that to you. Wrap your arms around Carrie and heal her in ways that we know you can. Whatever your will is, Lord, we pray that it happens in that situation. And wrap your arms around her family. They all love her. And they all love you. So help them to know that you are there with them. Give them peace and a comfort that just can't be explained, Lord. To know you're there no matter what. We continue to pray for Susan, Lord, that she continues to heal and she can get the treatments that she needs. And be with her family, Lord, that are caring for her right now. Be with them every step of the way, all along the journey. We pray for Rita, Lord. Please heal her of the pneumonia. And help the doctors and the medical team determine what is the best course of action for her back and get her back on the road to recovery. And Lord, we pray for Olivia this morning. She's young and she's got a lot of life and she could be doing anything right now, but she has chosen to do work for you. And Lord, I pray that you'll keep her safe in the travels, that you'll keep her safe in the work that she does, but that you will make an impact on people that will go far beyond what she will ever even realize. And be with her today and help her to feel your presence this entire way. We're so thankful for her and the work that she's doing and the heart that she has. And comfort her family too, as she's very, very far away. Lord, we love you. We give all of these things to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Stand up and worship with me one last time.
Somehow you don't see me like I do. Somehow you're when the whole world walks away, you're the God who stands with wide open arms, and you tell me nothing I have ever done could separate my heart from the God who stands.
Happy Sunday, everyone. Hope you have a great week.